I think we as a body have a responsibility to add our view in terms of how are things progressing in terms of children's services and the Children's Services Action Plan. Because as has been suggested in the audit letter, something that has qualified the final audit opinion, external audit opinion. That's serious stuff with the audit and risk committee. I think we should be, rather than saying, I'm sure the children's committee all sorted out, I think we should be taking on. I'm not consulting you, Tom, but I think we as a committee ought to be able to look at that as well, I think, and how we're progressing against what's the action plan. And how we, because I say, we're not making the improvements that were expected. So we need to understand that and what we're doing.
Tom, I think you want to come back on that.
Yeah, a couple of points there. Just to be clear on the business continuity plans, it doesn't say they're not in existence, it says they're not being reviewed and tested. So there are still plans in existence for those areas. It doesn't mean that they're completely getting to vote, there are plans, you just have been reviewed and tested.
They're soon enough to raise by Mark.
Yeah.
And in terms of, just to be clear on the qualification on the accounts have not been qualified. What has been proposed is the value from one conclusion, which is a by exception rule because of an issue regarding children's services. And that is standard practice, which I would confirm that is standard practice to any authority who has in year received an unfavourable offset report. That is standard practice. So our offset report came out in September 16. So it will affect the accounts both the 15-16 and 16-17.
And I might have been, sorry Chair, I might have been loose in my language there about the accounts. I didn't keep going to it saying it was the internal auditors or the external auditors' letter, the conclusion. But nonetheless, if the external auditor thinks it's serious enough to mention in his letter, but I don't want to be loose in my language, I think it's important enough for us to be monitoring how that progress is going as well. Because fundamentally, you, Adrian, will be held accountable in terms of this committee. It's doing its job to make sure we are covering off all the risks and that they are being managed effectively.
I want to try and take it away from this committee. There's a lot of detail in the report that goes to the Children's Committee. Committee. So rather than asking for loads of detail, there are more detail in the report that goes to that committee. There will be a lot more information that we've put in this report, which is giving you assurance that where it's going on in those key areas of the test of efficiency.
Can I ask a question, Tom? Is our role in this one actually then to see that the money has additionally been spent that we haven't expected to spend is being spent correctly in that area? So we don't have to see what they're doing, we just have to be assured that the money is being spent. That's what we need to do.
You want to be assured on your side. The work is being undertaken to rectify the issues that we have
Can I just make the point that this is not a scrutiny committee. The scrutiny committees have that role.
Yes. Yes.
That's worth it just bearing in mind.
Yes, but if we give them the paper, we've got to.
Yeah, can I ask, what is the role of the committee then, Chair? How is this committee satisfied that the money is being used correctly, if that's the case?
This committee has all the financial responsibility.
Well, how do we fulfil that?
I think we fulfil it by taking this report. I don't think Tom said we can't have it, but you were just saying.
So if you wanted the greater detail, I don't know whether in the Children's Committee there's more detail report that goes about the issues being addressed and how they're being addressed. But if we put this on this committee, it's not really the role of the board committee to delve into that. That's the Children's Committee.
We just want to monitor it so that an issue doesn't develop to the stage where for all this committee to do its job properly, we need to be monitoring that situation.
Can I ask the question again then? We're monitoring the risk, aren't we? So when there's reference to some parts not being done fast enough, it's not that we have to look at that because that's not our role. Our role is to check when more money is asked for or something else is required because there needs to be an extra boost in an area. That's our concern, isn't it?
Chair, David, these issues are here because they were significant governance issues.
Right.
Yeah.
So they're all the same. So
discussion we had about the business continuity, you're absolutely right to say to us, well, you know, you've got 26 plans, 21 of them can go through with this 5 to do with that series, and 20, there's 4 where they haven't been updated recently. It's the same principle applying to the, it's satisfying themselves with the compliance with the improvement notice that was issued is being proceeded with the right pace in the right way. And if you feel that there isn't enough in here, as Tom says, we can supplement it with other materials that's being used for other scrutiny. But it's the same principle as, so like I take away, and I will use that discussion that I just listened to go back to the ones that the business plans that haven't been done yet. It's the same process. You're satisfying yourselves that we are doing all we can as officers to comply with the significant governance system that we've identified.
And that's been identified again in the last one.
Just a very quick comment, Chair. So I think absolutely right, clearly there is a scrutiny committee and other people will be looking at the detail of the response to the inspection, but I think it's the role for this committee to satisfy itself with the overall progress of that. So I think there's sort of summary report coming to you, sort of saying, have you made the progress you expect to make? It will be exactly what you expect.
Thank you for that, Chair. We're going on then now to item 7. And welcome, Mr. Williams.
Yes.
I'm all down to the council, but I think we need to this committee.
Oh, I'm being the opposite word.
So, all do you agree? Right.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Chair. This report is a report which outlines the procurement rules approval documents that have gone through in compliance with the CPRs. There was a request at the 12th of June meeting here that this comes forward every 6 months. So this is the first 6-monthly report, which details all of the extensions, variations and waivers in compliance with contracts procedure rules. The exceptions, which are, we call PRAD 1, there are 27 of them. The extensions, which have been extended on the contract terms, there's 22. Variations, there's 13, which have been varied within the interest of the council. And the awards are awards over £500,000. There's one award which is slightly over that, but it's not of interest to the members. There are 5. I'm here to answer any questions if I can, and I endeavour to answer them. And if I can't, I'll come back to you because I think right of everything that's in the room. Thank you.
Sheila, go first.
The first one comment is right about is on 51. Who's paying for the festival of beautiful ideas?
I'm not this committee,
clearly. I ask because I was very pleased to see that we're all South Constituency Committee. We're paying for one-to-one counselling for young people and we're South. A joint venture between all three political parties.
Yeah.
But the festival of beautiful ideas and the scale, I'm just wondering if we were putting any money into that. And the next one is, it's just a query really, because I don't understand it on page 59. On the Rural Housing Affordable Housing Programme grant, it says, which makes sense, that Rural Methodist Housing Association is a veteran, they are a recipient who owns the land. It's that they are already registered providers of affordable housing. But the one that was a windmill in public house, was that owned by affordable housing as well?
I'll have to find that out fully from the actual managers involved in that. I think it's that presentation, but I can come back to you.
Right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Sure. Yeah, I think you're probably aware of the sort of thing I'm going to say, Chair, but I really worry around single tender action, which I think these are covered off, aren't they? To a large extent, when we look at things like, half a million quid for provision of litter enforcement. We've got 359,000 for supported housing. We've got 344,000 for green waste services, domiciliary care 1.7 million, etc. And I could but you'd be delighted to know, I won't go on. Though notice there's 1.1 million for the design and build. It strikes me as though, and again, bit of experience of this, we have a contracts forward look. Yeah, where I've seen operate, so you have a contracts forward look. So you know when the contracts are due to be renewed, and that you put in, make sure you put in place proper procurement around, and I'm sorry, that's not fair, you've abided by the rules, so. But you put in place arrangements to allow for a market test, if you're going to do a market test.
Yep.
And the reason we do market tests is because normally these things come back cheaper if you actually assess it. So, and the other thing, when we see these extensions, and you don't get it from this report, I don't know how many times these have been extended previously. So, the other thing that, again, we found, you know, and these were some of the things that were introduced because of austerity and all that, was that you look at how many times these things have just been extended and extended and extended and not tested. So, whilst I welcome the transparency of the fact these are being reported, I think that's right, it does concern me that we might not have a forward look tracker of when these contracts are coming up, and we are, you know, actually assessing whether the values of that £1 million is a lot, whether we are making sure that we are getting the best possible price for the right level of quality, and whether we should be building into that some market testing or some procurement arrangements. And if they're just going to continue, that should be priced in, and we should be getting it downside cheaper than we're getting already. But so there must be those arrangements.
Yeah, we do.
But there's one here, sorry.
Sorry, Jeff. Yeah, the exceptions are only allowed for 12 months in the first place. So there are exceptions have to have, in 380, we're listing those reasons that we can make an exception to contracts procedure rules. The variations.
And sorry, can I just say, I know there's a list, and I'm sure every one of them's got a list around, but I think what's not on the list is bloody hell, we haven't got the time to do it. So we're finding another item on the list to say, oh, well, that's why we're doing it. Because that's human nature, and I've seen it happen elsewhere.
There's also, sorry, the detail of the question that I assume.
Chris,
the contract was taken on again. Everybody agreed that they were rubbish at the job, but they changed the name of the company, and they were given the last contract.
We don't follow that through. We wouldn't do that.
Well, it was an action, was it?
Yeah.
Chair,
having come from a contracting background where it's normal to try and do these sort of things, or if you're on my side, try and get away with doing these sort of things, I'm just looking at the top of page 48, which is Chain Grow Live, 7.2 million. That seems a hell of an extension of a contract, if that figure is correct. It's things like that, and the logo for the one, I used to push. I've owned myself a Vogue Film in 1984, and you've got 26 million as a continuation contract there. Vogue Film aren't deemed in the business to be the cheapest provider of phone services. I wonder whether sometimes we need to just review our relationship with Vogue Film to see if there are the right people to continue with. But when you've got two contracts like that, and they're just extended, 7.2 million and 26 million, that to me is shining a very, very strong red light on whether we are investigating these things in view of our council responsibility to spend council taxpayers' money wisely.
We are, and we do investigate any extension or derogation that has to go forward. And there are extenuating circumstances in each case, and they have to go through a rigorous process before the commissioner is allowed to extend that process. I take your point on that. We're particularly one of the from at the moment is actually out to tender. And we're in the process of renewing that contract, taking it to competition. We expect that when, I haven't got the date when it's due to come in, but it's ready to come in now.
Can I make a point here? You said before that we're not a scrutiny committee.
Yeah, that's right.
So who
scrutinizes?
Who looks at that? I mean, I'm chair of the business committee. So shouldn't this, and this has never been brought to the business committee. So who, which committee should be screwed? Because these are significant amounts of money.
That's right.
Well, they're part of the contract procedure rules process, which this committee approved in 2015. And if you look at the documentation in the report itself, it can tell you what we've got to report to. If we are required to report to the business committee for these different processes that we've gone through, we will be able to do that. But I can tell you, all members, that we do scrutinise every one of these proposals before they're approved. And over those certain parties, they come through here.
We'd like to scrutinise that, just to make sure you're
right. Hold on a minute, Mike. Sorry, I'm going to bring Jeff in, if I may.
Sorry, Jeff.
Just come in, Chair. The vote of phone wants 26,000, not 26 million.
Sorry, I read that wrong.
Is that point?
Well, even if it's 26,000, it's...
My numbers were right, though. Yes, they were. But at the same time.
My question is, who's scrutinising? Your scrutiny.
Those extensions are within a formal procurement process. There are no extensions which aren't within the contract in the first place. Whenever an extension is asked for, we scrutinise and look at the market and make a judgment on it, as promised. So we wouldn't just extend it automatically. And the exceptions have very rigorous rules which are illustrated in this.
So am I saying you're looking at it now?
See, pardon?
You said before that it was under review now, but you got till March 2019. Extended it to them.
So. Oh, the Vodafone contract.
Look, can I just stop for a moment? Because I think it might be useful if we ask for a little bit of legal guidance from Philip. Because although we are not a scrutiny committee, nevertheless, there are matters which are scrutinised, but they're not scrutinised by this committee. So they will be subject to scrutiny in other areas. And I think really we need to have some understanding of what the role of this committee is in relation to scrutiny.
Can I ask as well if you're going to get this advice? Just my understanding is this committee is a council side committee, and the difference between us and a scrutiny committee is a scrutiny committee can advise. This committee is acting as council, so can therefore decide. So that, as I understand it, that's one of the key differences of us being a council side committee with very clear terms of reference that we follow through.
I'm trying to unravel that. It's not.
I always love it when I'm sitting somewhere quite nice, nicely napping away in the corner on the side. There's some legal advice on that. You're quite right, Councillor Green, in that this committee is different from any other. So it is a committee of council, but as such it does two things. One is it has a very specific function in terms of approving the accounts. Alongside those accounts, what used to be called statements of internal control, now much wider looking at corporate governance and is the council doing what it should do. The other element is not, as you say, not being scrutiny, which is there to hold the council's account, is there to take the wider view. So is the council doing what it ought to do with its money? A very important part of that is the contract procedure rules and standing orders, as we would say in old money, and is the council abiding by law in terms of the procurement regulations? So you are the place on the way to before council in terms of being the guardian of the contract standing orders. And this is where you're testing those standing orders and say, are they doing their job? Because their job is to make sure that there are things like proper, open and fair competition. There's the elements, as you've seen, as the policy came to capitalise over the social value of those. So that's something that is included in there. So is the council getting adequate financial and social return on what it's doing? And is it driving out the proper economy? And I think it's quite proper, as you've said here, if you spot something and go, that doesn't feel right, actually kicking it off to the appropriate scrutiny and saying scrutiny, yeah. I think you ought to scrutinise this, yeah.
We'll get under its skin, because we, or the the more straightforward and normal way is to go to cabinet and say to the cabinet member, actually, have you got sight of this? Are you happier? And there's one there with a big number. I've noticed alongside that big number it says, as approved by cabinet. So you should have some assurance that it's been through a full public scrutiny test. And some of the smaller numbers, yes, they're worth picking away at, but actually are the contract standing orders doing their job? So there's those two questions. One, is it doing its job? And then two, if there's something there that doesn't feel right, go away and see if it's right or not. And actually, if something really irritates, then off the cabinet or off the scrutiny, say to scrutiny, this is your area.
Reported to our council.
Because
we are council.
You are a mini version of council. You are a committee of council. So this is the job of full council, which is distilled down to this role. And for those of you who are familiar with that, fulfills a very similar role to the audit committee of any company, of any corporation. You are sitting slightly to one side, being non-political and bringing your influence to bear in terms of are things being done in the right way. And what the external auditors and internal auditors are there to help you poke at things.
I'm glad to say we have always been able to
Can I just ask how many times has something been referred to this committee which has been referred back to the cabinet member or referred to a specific scrutiny committee?
I think, for instance, the report you had of employment, of the wellness or attendance, that is a classic example.
So that would then be referred back to the cabinet member.
Yeah, it's come back from cabinet for your approval.
Being reported.
So on this specific, and you know, I'm sure the officers are doing due diligence, but nevertheless, we would, as elected members, we would like to look and make sure they are. So this particular point now that we're talking about, will this committee then refer it back to either the cabinet member or the relevant scrutiny committee just to have a look at it? Wouldn't make me feel better, sir.
Yes, that's a proposition.
That was an action.
To go to scrutiny, I would think it's the business committee, and we have a very full agenda, I might tell you.
We talk about setting this to scrutiny committee. We talk about setting the procedure and how it works and the functionality of a lot.
Yes.
Or are we talking about what you're saying, are we referring to the cabinet member, the appropriate cabinet member, or the scrutiny committee? Are we saying on each individual case? So, for instance, if it was an environmental issue that goes to the environmental committee, the scrutiny committee, or are you talking about the processes going to scrutiny?
If it goes to the scrutiny committee, we would be scrutinising the process.
Right. I think from what I understood it, is if it gets returned to scrutiny, it's on the individual case.
Yeah.
Not the process.
So I was picking up the individual item as opposed to
the process,
the process, because the process belongs here, all the process. The contract standing orders belong to
you. Can I ask a question for Andrew? Because just on this. So he's right in terms of it says the cabinet have considered it. That's £6.3 million worth. There's three items, and they've said exactly the same thing. So there's no individual on those three items on page 51. Community care and care watch and community care. You add those up together, that's around £6.3 million. That went through the cabinet on the basis of, well, exactly the same reason, people in terms of instability in the local domiciliary care market. That's probably because no one else can get in. Is there our approach might be. If I thought or we thought there was something remiss in terms of internal control that would allow our cabinet, notwithstanding the cabinet made the decisions for whatever reason, our role would be to speak to Mark potentially and say, that seems £6.3 million handed out in that way without any test of value for money, external test of value for money. That seems a bit odd. Even if it was the cabinet, our role would be to say to Mark, if you go and have a look at the processes that have been applied in these circumstances to allow that much amount of taxpayers' money to come through on a single tender action.
Absolutely, Chair. And I think, unless I'm reading this incorrectly, top of page 48 is 7.279.913 million. And that is the Chairman Grove line. That seems an awful lot to me. If I'm reading it correctly, I think I've got to put that to the point.
What's coming on now, please?
The government number. Mm-hmm. Which is 7.2 million.
They're not listed by value, are they? You have to.
£7.279.913 million.
Yes, that is correct.
And I think, for whatever reason, we need to know why, how, what the circumstances were that enabled that to just be extended like that.
Well, I think in the first instance we should be asking Mark to look at that.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.